Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. More than 150 journalists are currently imprisoned in Turkey. President Erdogan's government stands accused of an all-out assault on freedom of expression. My guest today is Can Dündar, former editor of the Turkish daily Cumhuriyet, who has experienced imprisonment, life-threatening violence, and exile in the last couple of years after publishing material which infuriated the Turkish president. In the battle for Turkey's future and its soul, who's winning? Can Dündar, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
You live in Germany. You would like to live in Turkey, but it's not possible. Do you feel a sense of freedom in Germany, in Germany that you couldn't enjoy in your last period inside Turkey?
You can't really feel as a free man while your friend's in jail, your family is under, you know, away from you, and at the same time, you are threatened by a very despotic government, and if you are seen as a threat by the government, you can't be free, feel free everywhere in the world, you know, nowhere in the world.
Do you have security right now? Because of course, a part of your story over the last couple of years is not just arrest and imprisonment, but also there was an attempt on your life. Do you feel secure in Germany?
Not really, because Turkish intelligence is so active in Germany, and there are a lot of pro-government people, pro-Erdogan people living in Germany. That's why there's a huge campaign against me by the Turkish government. That's why it's a kind of, it's not the safest place in the world, Germany is.
Do you have security?
Yeah, I do have security. If I do something in public, they come and protect me.
I suppose your story is very much about your relationship with President Erdogan. And I am interested to go back in time to the early 2000s when you described yourself as cautiously optimistic about him. You said that here is a man who stands up to the military. Do you think, in retrospect, that you totally misunderstood the man?
I guess he was pretending like a Democrat at those years, and he had a plan from the beginning. And he convinced many of Turkish liberals, together with the Western governments, that he's a Democrat, and he's trying to get the Turkish army back to the barracks again. And we were, you know, so critical about the Turkish army being so involved in Turkish politics. That's why someone who were promising to get the army back to the barracks was, you know, we should give him a chance. But we knew that he was not a Democrat because he said already during his, as a governor of Istanbul, back to 1996, he said, democracy is not my main aim, it's just a tool.
Let's get to the unfolding of events in more recent times. You knew that as the century proceeded, as we got to 2010, 2012, that Erdogan was showing a much more authoritarian streak in his rule. Yeah. But you took some rash decisions. I mean, for example, when you became editor-in-chief of Cumhuriyet, you must have known that breaking this story in 2015 about the Turkish government smuggling arms over the border to rebels in Syria, you must have known that running that story would put an enormous strain, to say the least, on your relationship with the government.
Of course, we knew it. In a way, we were expecting it. Because as a journalist, of course, you must be realistic about this. But what would you do? I mean, you have a story which is true. Your government is doing something illegal and hiding it and naming it as a state secret. And you are a journalist. This is your duty.
Well, it was a state secret. Clearly, it was a state secret. It was a covert operation. Nobody was supposed to know about it. That's the point of covert operations.
It was Turkey's Iran gate. So in a way, it was not the state secret. It was the secret of Mr. Erdogan. So he was trying to get involved in Syrian war in an illegal way.
Well, but put yourself in the shoes of a journalist in a different country. I mean, frankly, if a British journalist had tried to dig deep into the affairs of military intelligence in the UK or the same thing in the United States, they would have run into serious trouble. We have something called the Official Secrets Act.
Have you seen the film The Post?
I have seen the film The Post, which concerns Vietnam and the uncovering of the Pentagon Papers.
So they were right to publish the story. And it's more or less the same story with us, with a very different ending, unfortunately. But, I mean, this is our duty to inform the public about this kind of thing.
Well, yes, but presumably as a Turk, you also have an obligation and a duty to consider things like putting Turkish military personnel or others at risk. And you do know that the Turkish government insisted that what you had uncovered was not gun running to rebels, but was actually the transfer of aid and assistance to Turkmen civilians. That's what Mr. Erdogan said.
That's what they said, but the Turkmens denied this allegations, you know, that they said they didn't get any armory from this. And we knew that Turkey had a very close contact with the Islamist guerrillas in Syria, and we were opposing it, you know. So that's why it was important.
But looking back, knowing what you know about what's happened to you, do you have any regrets?
Not at all. Not at all.
None at all.
I would do the same again.
But again, to be fair to the Turkish government, you went through due process. Erdogan, we know, was furious with you. He described what you did as espionage. He said that those who wrote that will be punished. But he didn't do it himself. He filed a complaint and the courts took it up and you were tried in a court of law.
Exactly. And unfortunately, the courts are all controlled by himself, you know, nowadays.
Well, that's your opinion.
Oh, yeah. I mean, so when he ordered a kind of complaint or he defined me as a traitor or a spy, no judge can, you know, decide the other way.
You spent 92 days in prison in the course of the legal process before the actual conviction. What were those 92 days like?
I was in solitary confinement. So, in a way, I was ready, because if you're a journalist in Turkey, you must be ready for any kind of insults, imprisonment, harassment, even being killed. So, psychologically, I felt ready. And immediately, I start working and writing and try to give a voice to the world that's something going on in the country.
See, that's what strikes me about Turkey. It's complex to make sense of the nature of the authoritarianism that we talk about in Turkey. Because there you sit in prison. Erdogan has declared you an enemy of the state. And yet you're free to write. You're free to express your opinion. You can get that opinion to the outside world. I mean, this isn't exactly North Korea, is it?
But how come it was difficult? It was not easy to do it. You know, you're taking some risks to do it. Of course, I mean, you're not allowed to write, in a way, but you must be brave enough to, you know, to do it. So everything, you can do everything in Turkey, but the price is high. If you're ready to pay the price, you're free to do it. You're free to write. You're free to, you know, talk. But the price is really high, so you can spend the whole day, whole life in jail.
Well, that's a very interesting way of putting it. The price is very high. In the end, you chose to avoid paying some of that inevitable price by, when you were released on appeal, you fled. I mean, you were invited to Germany to receive a journalistic prize, and you decided not to go back.
Well, not partly true, because after I was released, I spent 5 months in Turkey. I got back to my job again, but it was summertime, and I went to holiday to Spain. In fact, I was in Spain. Then this military coup attempt has happened in Turkey. Then the rule of law lifted, and my lawyers advised me to stay away from the country for for a while, and that's why I decided to stay in Germany.
Was it partly out of fear? Because I referred earlier to the attempt on your life. A gunman approached you outside the court one day, and miraculously you survived, even though he tried to shoot you at very close range. But was it fear that drove you out of Turkey in the end?
Of course. I mean, otherwise, being in jail doesn't matter. You can stay in jail for a while. But if your life is in danger, of course, you should think twice.
It wasn't the Turkish state, though, was it? I mean, there has been a legal proceeding against the gunman, and there's no connection, it seems, between him and the Turkish state.
He said he was inspired by the accusations of the statesman, and he's free now with his passport in his pocket.
That clearly is a bitter thing for you to swallow.
Oh, yeah, of course. My wife hasn't got a passport, but he has, so...
You talk about your wife, Dilek. She's in Turkey. She's not free to travel. She's been stopped from visiting you in Germany.
Yeah, she was stopped in the airport and taken hostage, really. I mean, without any accusation. There's no accusation against her, no investigation. And she's done nothing rather than marrying me.
How hard is that? Because you have no prospect of going home. She has no prospect of leaving Turkey.
This is the price the president talking about. So this is part of the deal. And he loves taking hostages. And he tries to punish me by, you know, keeping the family away from each other.
This is a strange word to use, but do you feel a sense of guilt about your situation? Because you are now in Germany, you're here in the UK, a play is being produced about some of your experiences. You know, you're something of a well-known figure now in the Western media. And yet your wife is stuck in Turkey. But more than that, many of your colleagues on the Cumhuriyet newspaper are facing more legal proceedings. Many of them, I think 16 of them, have been in prison since you got out of the country. There are 150 journalists in all currently in prison. Thousands have lost their jobs. Do you feel awkward about being outside of Turkey?
Yeah, partly so, because, of course, if I was in Turkey, I would be in jail or in the cemetery, wherever. So, but I'm not silent, you know, so I'm still struggling for something. I'm still writing and talking about my country and defending our freedom, our democracy. So I really believe in the future. So in Turkey, I wouldn't be so vocal, but now I have the opportunity to talk to the people and to the world about Turkey.
Yes. We interviewed Mr. Erdogan last year on Hard Talk. This is what he said about the accusation that he has repressed freedom of expression systematically in his country. He said no one is jailed because of journalism. Right now in Turkey, there are many opposition journalists who write a lot of things, all kinds of articles, all kinds of insults, and they are still out there. And those who are in jail, well, they are criminals. They have no title as journalists.
Yeah, exactly. So I've been working as a journalist for more than 35 years now and convicted as a terrorist. So there are a lot of journalists like me. So in his eyes, if you are criticizing the government, you're a terrorist. That's why he doesn't accept that there are journalists in jail, because in his eyes they are not journalists. But they are journalists. They are my friends and my colleagues. And they've done nothing but write and criticize the government.
Explain to me how Mr. Erdogan is still, according to the opinion polls, by far the most popular politician in Turkey. Explain to me how it looks as though he can expect to be in power because of that popularity until perhaps 2029. The man dominates Turkey, despite all of the things you say about him. Yeah. He is the man.
He is the man. Imagine yourself in his shoes, and you're the president, and you have the authority to dominate the government, the parliament, the judiciary, media, the universities, business, and you are the sultan. And every kind of criticism banned, and you're not allowed to make a demonstration about the government. against the government. It must be so easy to run such a country. So,
but is there not also a question about you and your colleagues in the secular, liberal, progressive media? Isn't there a question which says, for all of your bravery and courage, and I do not belittle that in any way, you appear to be out of touch with many of your countrymen and women?
I mean, the question should be the other way around. How come under these circumstances, half of the people still resisting him in such a country under these circumstances? Really, I mean, it's very surprising for us to see 50% of the people voted against him in the last referendum. It is bravery.
What about Fethullah Gulen and the idea, and again, the Turkish state is very clear about this, the idea that Gulen and his networks have, and we saw it perhaps manifested in the accusation that he was behind the coup of 2016, Gulen and his network are trying to erode Turkish democracy, and Erdogan is making a stand for the institutions of the state against a movement which wants to corrupt those institutions.
I guess this is one of the issues that I agree with him.
Are you a Gulenist?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm not a Gulenist. I agree with Erdogan.
I know, but there are people, yeah, including the Turkish foreign minister, who've suggested that Cumhuriyet is full of Gulenists.
Yeah, that's the point. In fact, if someone is Gulenist in Turkey, number one is Erdogan. So President Erdogan, hand in hand with Mr. Gulen, they run the country together for years. And Gulen was in charge of the bureaucracy, universities, media, and education system, and Erdogan was in charge of the money, in fact. So we were criticizing both of them. And now Erdogan understood that Gulen is not the right guy to be a partner with.
So he has to do something. And again, to quote the Turkish foreign minister who spoke just a few days ago, he said, we are going through a necessary phase during which we make sure that the FETÖ, that is the Gulenist movement members, including the sleeper cells, are removed from all positions of power in the media, business and academia. It is a painful process, he said, but we act within the law.
Within the law. Yeah, they inserted all the Gulenists into the state machinery. And as a, you know, a parallel state, and they made it. And now the creator attacked the creator. You know, it's a Frankenstein story. And now they are accusing us for being a Gulenist. And, you know, everyone opposing the government nowadays branded like a Gulenist. That's the thing. So I have nothing to do with them.
The thing is, the outside world looks at this, and perhaps at times it is a little confused about what's going on in Turkey.
Yeah.
Would it be fair to say that you have been gravely disappointed with the reaction, for example, of the European Union in recent months in terms of what you want to see, which is an isolation and condemnation of Erdogan?
Unfortunately, yeah. I'm so much deeply disappointed by the attitudes of the Western governments. Due to the refugee crisis, in fact, they...
They need Mr. Erdogan to...
Yeah, they didn't want to annoy him, and they want someone to lock the refugees in Turkey, and the key owner was Erdogan, so they made a really dirty deal with Erdogan, and the deal was they kept a kind of close eye to the Erdogan's aggression, and in return, Erdogan kept the refugees in Turkey.
Well, you say a dirty deal. I mean, others would say it's practical politics.
Sure.
To quote a former EU commissioner, Gunter Verheugen, he said the other day, actually it was the end of last year, but in the midst of this negotiation of what Turkey could do to stem the flow of refugees into Europe, he said, the truth is the European Union needs Turkey more than Turkey needs the European Union right now.
Yeah, what about the principles? What about democracy? I mean, we've been fighting for democracy. So-called Western ideals like democracy, human rights, press freedom, equality of men and women, secularism. And to see the European leaders at the other side is really disappointing. So they should be supporting democracy in Turkey, but instead they just ignore it. I mean, ignore the issue.
But you're in a difficult position because on the one hand, you seem to be arguing for the isolation of Erdogan and the Turkish government by the European Union. And yet, on the other hand, surely the whole point of your position is that you want bridges to be built between the European Union and Turkey. So what message would it be sending if Turkey was completely isolated?
Because Turkey is not equal to Erdogan. So Erdogan should be isolated. Turkey shouldn't. And there's another Turkey. And it's not only Erdogan, you know, so the opponents. The freedom fighters in Turkey, Democrats, and, you know, 50% of Turkey.
But you're asking the EU then to interfere in Turkish internal affairs?
No. I mean, I don't expect anything from the European governments. But, for example, take this, I mean, play. I mean, the British artists trying to give hand to the Turkish democracy by just, you know, playing something about Turkey. And some publishing houses playing, you know, publishing books about Turkey, some universities accepting Turkish academics, and trade unions, parties, women organizations. Mm. I'm talking about this. I mean, don't isolate Turkey. Well, and make Turkey a member in this family.
That's a very interesting point you're making, because I know you're over here to work on a play. It's called We Are Arrested. It's based on your memoir written, I believe, when you were imprisoned.
Exactly.
Yeah, and now the Royal Shakespeare Company, no less, is putting it on as a play here in the United Kingdom. How important is that sort of cultural messaging and reaching out across the world for you today? Does it make your life worth living?
Amazing, yeah. This is the lifelong experience. It was a testimony in my book, and I've got a call from Royal Shakespeare Company saying that we just want to make a play out of it.
Do you think it'll make a difference?
Of course. I mean, it's a very important solidarity message for us, and at the same time, it's a kind of punishment for the aggressive governments saying that art is much more valuable than your daily politics, you know. So it will stay for years. But what about Erdogan?
You wrote that in prison, so there is no doubting that your determination to keep talking, expressing yourself, is there. But surely at times you have to think twice. Your wife is still stuck inside Turkey. You have other family inside Turkey. Are you in any way now self-censoring because you are so concerned about them?
Very important question. At least you have to think twice what you write and what you talk. I talked to my wife and she let me go, you know. She said, okay, don't think about me because this is our struggle. But of course, this is the logic of taking hostages. If your friends or you're in jail, your family is there, of course you have to think twice, and this is a kind of new censorship.
Do you think you will ever be able to live with your wife again?
Of course. I'm so hopeful about Turkey's future. And we are coming to the end of this darkest hour. I saw the film yesterday night. So unfortunately, Turkey is now witnessing its
How can you say that with such optimism? As we've discussed, Erdogan's grip on your country is tighter than ever.
Yeah, but on the other hand, we have still half of the people resisting, and just on the Women's Day, I mean, the streets were full of women resisting, even if it's dangerous and risky for them. So this country would not surrender, and that's why I'm so optimistic about the future.
John Dündar, thank you for being on Hard Talk.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.